everybody. I was going to make another role play today, and then I read a lot of comments that a lot of you are really liking the ear-to-ear kind of videos, so I thought I would do something simple for you. And so I am going to show you this book, and I have shown a little of this book before in a video, but a lot of you had expressed an interest in seeing a little more of the book. So today I am just going to sit with you, and I am going to show you a little bit of this art of Mass Effect book, and turn the pages, point out some things that I really, really love, and also I'll just I'll read a little bit of it to you, just maybe some passages here and there, and I hope you'll enjoy that. So I'm going to set the book in front of us so you can read it along with me, which I think will be nice, and that way I will also whisper right into your ear, and it will be like that. So I'm excited to look through this book. It's so, so wonderful. So let's get started. Okay. Okay, so we're gonna start looking at the book, and I'm really sorry if the camera does some auto-focusing. It just wants to. So today we're gonna be talking about Mass Effect. Mass Effect is one of my favorite trilogies, and I think that they are some of the very best games, and some of the most influential games ever made. So anyway, so I'm gonna show you a little bit of this book, and the book is all about the art of the Mass Effect universe. So let's open it up. And it's nice and black, like space. So, this is a very dramatic scene. And I will try not to feature too many spoilers. Yeah, this here is the male Shepard with his omni-tool and his N7 armor. And some people think of him as the default. However, it may not surprise you that my default shepherd is the female shepherd, and it's not just because she's female, but mostly because the voice actress who performed her was so good. Her name is Jennifer Hale. If you've played many video games, you'll have heard her voice before. She is entirely wonderful. This shepherd has red hair, but I made mine blonde. Surprise, surprise. So self-involved. But I like that you can make your shepherd just the way you want him or her to be. This is a very naughty Turian, very bad. So we start talking about Mass Effect 1. And right off, we can see some of the designs. This is for the matriarch, Benezia. And this is for that Turian I told you about, Saren. I love the Turians. Turians are made to look like a lot of different animals combined. They have very, like, avian-type legs. You can see, but I think that their heads look like cats. They look like cats. And I like anything that looks like a cat. You can see all of the sketches, and you can sort of see the evolution of the armor, and of the head. There's all these different heads. You can sort of see how they evolve. And then, of course, developing the humans is maybe a little bit easier, but still very complicated. Especially trying to predict what, you know, kinds of hair and what kinds of fashion they'll have, even in their armor. So, of course, just like in many games, there are all these stages of development. Ashley, who sometimes is looking very, like, tough and serious and ultimately a little bit more feminine. And then the same with Caden and all of the humans. A challenge for designers. It's quite difficult. I mean, less now than it used to be, but it's quite difficult to animate hair that really moves on its own, you know? Because hair, it just wants to go everywhere, you know? Swoosh. It wants to, like, swoosh around. the great mystery. Of course, yes, the Quarians. And we really don't ever completely find out what's underneath the mask, but we can sort of see maybe how it evolved. Sort of more human, more like a Solarian, and so on. Of course, there have been a couple photos, or not photos, but pictures, renderings released of what Tali Zora looks like under her mask. So, but they need the mask to be able to breathe. They are nomadic, and so they're very sensitive because they live in their own contained ships, in their own fleet. Now the Elcor are my favorite. You can see the Elcor. I had always hoped, kind of, for a playable Elcor. But there were a lot of thoughts. They kind of wanted to have these more, these more outrageous kind of features. If you look at this one, it reminds me of the character of No Face from Spirited Away movie. And then this one, here, it reminds me of Cthulhu. Cthulhu. I hope that's the right way to say it. I quite like stories about Cthulhu. So, anyway, like his face, you know. And there are Volas. Volas. We're always sort of short in stature, and the developers say that's to give them a more docile look. And they also need a full body suit, just like the Quarians do. But the developers wanted them to seem somewhat innocuous, and they do somewhat remain that way. The Geth are sort of the most interesting design for me because they wanted to make something that would be stand out and could possibly be very frightening at times, but would also seem unique to other sci-fi creatures and other mythologies and canons and series. So first they came up with the armor, because we always see Geth armor, and then that determines the actual anatomy of the Geth, and sometimes they're very kind of creepy crawly. This reminds me a little of the, what are they, like face lickers or something from Resident Evil, but ultimately, the Geth become more, I guess it's not correct, but more humanized. They become more understandable and complex. And anyhow, this is the Thorian. Ooh, he's kind of gross, huh? I actually think he's a little cute. Poor Thorian. quite intentional. So I guess they, it says here, this is so funny, it says the Thorian. The Thorian was lovingly referred to as grotesque sack around the office. It's just funny. Okay. No, I love the Rachni. They're so, 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 so cute, aren't they? I just love them. And, I guess they were wondering, these needed to look sort of like weapons. The Rachni, needed to be enclosed for the story, so they needed to think about those constraints. And I love that. And sometimes necessity is just, well, they say the mother of invention, right? Now, the Citadel is meant to represent the entire sort of galaxy in terms of its architecture, and of everyone kind of coming together. The Citadel really, though, becomes its own character. And so the lines and the really dominant curves of it can be seen as motifs throughout the design of the whole game, even in the logos and even in some of the menus. You'll see it actually very famously, there's a menu base that is round, so you'll see that repeated again and again and again. And I think this pretty well represents that the Citadel is breathtaking. It just is. I think if you've ever started playing the game and you haven't made it to the Citadel yet, you must, because the Citadel feels real to me. It feels how I could actually see human civilization one day. So it has this circle. What's it called? The Palestinian or something like that? And then these big, big, long arms and the cityscape. So it's really, it's just such an accomplishment, even just in fantasy, you know. And you see, these are some of the other planets and civilizations, and you see the Great Great Range. I believe Vermeer was inspired partially by Phuket. And Phuket is just like that. And here's all these different places, and some of them are quite scary. Some of them are quite lush. Some of them are very icy and very, very cold. And Eden Prime, sort of like I guess this is where the whole plot germinates. But you can see the range of palette, and it's just staggering. Ooh. That was a cracky page. And Ilos, anyhow, Pharaohs. and the Normandy, of course. And you can see all these different designs for the Normandy. And the ship was designed to sort of serve multiple purposes. So they say at first, early concepts of the Normandy explored the ship as a fighter, a cruiser, a smuggler ship, and a stealth vessel. And it's interesting because the Normandy has to be all of those things. It's a character and a setting, sort of like the Citadel. And more and more throughout the series becomes involved in action, and it evolves. And then it has away vehicles, so that there's lots of mobility there from the Normandy. And I am in the minority, but I just love the Mako, which you could cruise around in on planets. And you would never, ever, ever fall over, which is so cool. I love it. If you've ever played the game Skyrim before, totally different game, but you'll have you can get a horse in Skyrim. I always call it the Mako horse because no matter what you do, that horse will not fall. He won't fall over. Can kind of defy physics the way the Mako did. We have all this great information about helmets and mass relays, all of the logos, all of the weaponry. And all of the weaponry is very, very, very convertible. And they were all designed so that they could fit on the back of Shepard. Many, many games have strange, invisible inventories where you can have gun, and all kinds of guns. And they just disappear when you don't use them. Which is kind of silly. So all of the guns they made for Mass Effect were meant to fit on Shepard's back. And you can see them on his or her back as you play. So many of them sort of fold or convert or are very, very easy to holster. You'll see all these different holsters. And anyway, I personally always prefer ranged weapons. I think it's fun. The really, really ambitious undertaking of Mass Effect is that you don't just create a single technology or a single style or a single biology or a single architecture. But you have to create those things for every different species and planet. Mass Effect 2 introduced the elusive man, and you can see all this smoke here. Smoke. And this is a very dramatic silhouette, isn't it? You kind of get a rebooted Shepard. And this whole cast of characters who are wonderful favorite for obvious reasons. She is played by Yvonne Strahovski. I don't know. You'll correct me. But she's really beautiful, obviously. In real life, Yvonne is blonde, but they opted to make her have darker hair. I think part of it was because they have her in white, and her white Cerberus outfit with these sort of honeycombs, it does look much better with the dark hair, doesn't it? So, and then you have Jacob. He's a good guy, but like a lot of, he's just kind of like Caden to me. He's a little bit boring. I felt that some of the human males in the series were boring, but not Garrus Vagarian. He's so freaking cool. I like Garrus because he's really tough, but he doesn't act like it. And Garrus is really smart and really silly. I think that Tally, the Corian, is maybe sort of like that. You know, she's smart and she's sort of sarcastic, Tally. So I think a lot of people, they like Tally too. She's an engineer. She's very cool. Grunt is a youngin, very, very young, but very, very angry, sort of like that, like angsty. Oh, and here's my favorite. See, everybody, this is Thane. Now, in Mass Effect, you get to choose, like, who you fall in love with. This is my man. I love Thane. He's very serious, but he's so, so smart. So sensitive to everything going on around him. Very, very analytical. I love how they give him these big black eyes to sort of suggest a depth that really can't be fathomed. And Thane is an assassin. He's an assassin with a heart of gold. Of course. No. If you do fall in love with Thane, and he falls in love with you, he calls you Sia. Sia. I think it's nice. Sia. 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 Yeah. I love Legion. So cool. Legion is the Geth. The Geth is Legion. Jack is cool. You can see her development is very trying to sort of appropriate a kind of punk type style. They even go into listing her tattoos, all her tattoos. She has tattoos everywhere. And, this explains a little about what her tattoos mean. You can see originally, they didn't even have her wearing a top because she has so many tattoos, but they opted to put like this tiny little strap on her for modesty. Modesty strap. Jack is a bionic. Samara. These I'll just flip through to show you some more of the cool characters. Zaid. Kasumi is so cool. Such beautiful art, so I love the palette. It really changes with the tone. The elusive man is like the coolest man you'll ever meet. And I think that it seems they arrived quite quickly at the idea of his concept, that he would be watching a dying star, and it's kind of an interesting statement, because there's a sense of knowing what's ahead, and there's a sense of sort of villainous inevitability. He's really quite a compelling character, played by Martin Sheen, right? I think so. It's been so long since I played. Well, a long time in my world for a video game. I play video games enough that if it's been like a year or more I played a game, then it feels like a long time. So here's Omega, which featured heavily in a DLC later on, and you can see it's designed like a jellyfish. The artists were, and again you can see the theme of circles, of rings, which play nicely into the themes of it as well, that there's a cycle, right? So everywhere you look, whether it's representing something sinful or something heavenly or pure, there's always rings or ripples or circles or curves. Anyway, Omega features heavily in DLC later on, so well conceived as sort of a seedy underworld. Ilium is where the Asari are from, and you can see the, I believe it is, and you can see the purple and the blue that are in the characters as well, kind of worked out in Ilium. So, the Citadel too, it changes, everything changes. And there's just, I think one of my favorite thoughts here is that the reason all of this feels familiar, even though it's so fantastical, is because it's all sort of rooted in what makes us human. Power and loss and wanting to become better. Circles and circles and circles and tachanka. That's a good word to say, isn't it? Tachanka. 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 I like that. Tachanka. Tachanka. Tachanka is the name of the planet for the Krogans here. The junka. Horizon, and I always love getting to sort of the lovely, lush worlds. Purgatory. Very, very scary prison. I think if anything though, just by looking at the pictures, you can see that there's this wonderful tone that shifts and shifts and shifts and shifts. And like even in the migrant fleet here, which the Cylons and to the people. So, anyway, I highly recommend the art book just so you can see how wonderful. And what I was saying before, this is even underwater, which is so crazy, scary. But you see that they're, unlike a lot of sci-fi, Mass Effect has so many tonal shifts. It can be so funny, and it can be very deadly serious. And all the collectors, so interesting. It's almost like being inside a body. Like a terrible, terrible version of the magic school bus or something. Anyway, so cavernous and big, but I think that all of these atmospheres and characters reflect that there's just endless shifts. See, you can even get a puppy. You can get a puppy dog, which is my favorite part, is getting the dog. He doesn't even do very much. He just like walks around in your deck, but I love him. And again, circles and circles and circles. And Mass Effect 3. And I think you'll just find, you see here, even see Ashley finally gets nice long hair. And Caden finally gets a personality. I don't necessarily love all the like macho James Vega. He's a little too macho for me. But I think that they wanted someone who is like, you know, a real like tank character. I'm sorry, you can hear my kitty in the background. He wants some attention. Anyway, and Jack, she gets more hair. So cool. So I highly recommend taking this journey if you haven't. It's so memorable. And I honestly wish I could play it for the first time all over again. But I know I'll go, you know, I've played it through a couple times, but I know I'll play it again and again. So anyway, I'll just show you a couple more so that you can see most of the book, but these are all just different variations of monsters, I guess, but I always find the monsters to be so, so cute. I love the monsters. And finally, of course, Earth, which is probably the most powerful landscape you'll see. Their idea of Earth was heavily, heavily influenced by Vancouver. If you've ever been to Vancouver, you know that there are all of these towers, and there's lots of water, and it's very blue because there's so much glass, and everything sort of reflects. But seeing real places like Earth, seeing Mars, how we might develop it, is really, really fascinating to me, and I just love it. So, oh look, it's the junka. And you finally get to go to pretty much everybody's home world. Oh, sassy, so that's where, I'm sorry, I think I got confused. But you can see anywhere where the Asari are, anywhere that's really like sacred to They are sorry. You'll notice their colors, the palettes, like purple, pink, and blue. And of course, Cerberus headquarters finally. My very, very favorite landscape or setting. I don't even think it's featured in here because it's such a spoiler, but one of the very last places you go, there's like bodies everywhere, which seems really scary. But I just love when this game becomes, you can see it's quite action oriented by all the weaponry here, but I love when it gets to be kind of horror-esque. I really love the horror influence. There are definitely those moments, so. And I won't talk much about the crucible, but you can see again it looks quite like the mass relays and all that other stuff, so. Anyway, thanks for looking through the book with me. Finally, you see again, you'll always notice that the scenes that are most important in this have the palette of blue and orange. Blue and orange, sort of like life and chaos. And then we fade to black. I hope you've liked it, and I'd love to hear all your thoughts about the game too, okay? Okay, good night.